Hello and welcome back to the Proactive Webinar Series. And today we're focusing resources and also the valuation proposition of each company. We will hear from Australian Gold and Copper, Magmatic Resources and Sipper Resources. Presentations will be 12 minutes followed by a Q&A. Questions can be emailed through to myself at john.phillips@proactiveinvestors.com or text through to 0431 597 771. I'd now like to welcome our first presenter, Glenn, on behalf of Australian Gold and Copper. Do we have you there, Glenn?
Right here. Thanks, John.
Welcome.
Great to be here. Thanks, everyone, for joining in. Really exciting story growing here out of an IPO in January. On the 20th of January, we IPO'd. We got started drilling before the end of January. So we're straight out there and we've had lots of good positive news come in since then. So we're a New South Wales focused organic growth exploration company looking for gold and copper with strong copper and gold assets in the central Lachlan fold belt. So primarily focused around the Cobar Basin. So home to world-class miners. We've got Rio Tinto, we've got Sandfire, we've got Aurelia, we've got Glencore. They're all in this basin. It's a really prolific basin. We've had this year already, we've had some fantastic drill results and really indicative of some great discoveries that have happened in the area by other companies just north of us. The Federation deposit by Aurelia has just absolutely blossomed this area. Constellation keep coming out with just stellar results. 18 metres at 9% copper about a week ago. And Mallee Bull by Peel. So some really strong discoveries shows that this district is just still ripe, still blossoming. I mean, Constellation was discovered under only 1 meter of cover. So very shallow results. And diamond drilling on our Achilles project is underway as of today. So they're collaring today. We mentioned in our announcement a week ago that we've got some great results, 85 metres at 0.13% copper, more distal lead zinc on the peripheries, but nice copper bismuth in the hot zone there. And we're going to be drilling underneath it. So that's just a really a warm, fuzzy feeling in my stomach. So lots of news flow coming over the next little while. Then straight after this diamond drill hole, our most advanced project is Moorfield. Moorfield is a gold project and we've got some really strong gold results that we're following up and going to be drilling underneath. So lots of news flow at Moorfield gold project coming up. So we're really well funded. So there's lots of reasons to buy our stock, lots of cash and a low EV like so many of the other peers as well. So strong shareholder backing, strong board shareholding as well. So we've got lots of reasons to leverage off. So world-class location, world-class portfolio, pure exploration, organic growth, exploration play for gold and copper. Lots of drill programs. We've had 5 drill programs already out of our IPO. We've drilled 6,500 meters of RC drilling since IPO only 8 months ago, 9 months ago. So, and we've still got more to come this year. So we've had lots of news flow and we're going to have lots of news flow coming up. We've got a bit of an alliance here with Magmatic Resources. Peter Duerden is talking next. We share an office. We share an exploration office in New South Wales, in Orange, New South Wales. We've got geologists in here who have all got wonderful discoveries under their belt and great track record. So it's a real think tank. We share costs and we keep those overheads really low. So that's a really strong point from this slide. We've got a strong board and that strategic alliance with Magmatic Resources. So 3 projects, Moorfield, our gold project with significant gold intercepts there, 36 metres at 1.2, 30 metres at 1.6. That's a strong gold project going forward that we're going to be drilling in November. Cargelego project is the flavor right now that we're diamond drilling as of later this afternoon. We're just masting up today, which is exciting, and our Gundagai project, a big McPhillamys like target down there that we're going to be drilling as well. So an indicative time frame, this is just our drilling. We've got other key exploration in there as well, soils and et cetera, et cetera. But we're just showing the how much drilling is happening over the next little while. So an exciting program coming up. Straight to Kargeligo. So Cobar Basin, where Sandfire, Aurelia, Rio Tinto, Glencore, Aeris Resources, Helix Resources, they've all had incredible track records, and Peel as well. All having great success for gold, base metals, and lead, zinc, and copper. These are polymetallic systems. You can see there, we are not exploring under deep cover here. That is a massive sulfide vein outcropping on surface. We're drilling just north of that, and we've just finished off our phase two RC program. We're really mapping out this system. It's 3 kilometers long, and we're getting some great results out of that. Earlier this year in May, we announced 5 meters at 4.9% lead plus zinc, bit of copper, and the best meter there was a meter at 10.5% lead plus zinc, 1.5% copper. And we just announced a week ago that we got 85 meters at 0.13% copper. So, those two intercepts, the base metals and the copper, the 85 meters, they're about 600 meters away from each other. And we're seeing indications of this system open to the north, open to the south, and open to the east. So when you put a drill hole underneath all this, and we're our diamond hole is a very exciting hole. So we tried very hard, a big push with us and this project is this EM conductor down deep, which the New South Wales government flew, and we were the direct beneficiaries of this EM conductor. So we have been stepping down towards this, first with soils, then with RC drilling, and we're getting closer and closer. It's a huge EM conductor. We didn't want to just go and put a big 500 meter whopping grade hole into it straight away. We wanted to de-risk it and get results as we go down. And literally we're 150 meters away from this. We're going to be drilling 150 meters under our 85 meters at 0.13. Bit of high grade stuff there, 25 meters at 0.2, couple of meters there at 0.5%. And it keeps getting stronger. The thing we love about this story is the bismuth, which is a pathfinder element. The bismuth increases with depth towards the heat source. The copper increases with depth towards the heat source, and the lead zinc drops away. Now, lead zinc in these ore bodies are considered the lower temperature minerals. So the lead and the zinc are more distal, and the copper and the bismuth is closer to the heat source. And these are just pure lead, pure copper bismuth intercepts. Bismuth is a pathfinder, but so we've got the right alteration in these rocks. We've got the right copper and the bismuth story. And this 500 meter diamond hole has many reasons to be drilled now. So that's been collared today. And I just invite you all to watch this story over the next month. Should take about 2.5 weeks to drill this one. So very exciting, and to see what we're going to get. Also mapping out the geology we need to find with this diamond hole. We need to learn from it and find the higher grade zones within it. So it's a very exciting proposition. So that project has attracted a fair bit of news. We were on 7 News down there in Sydney, and they've sent out a film crew and filmed us, and it was all very, very exciting. So a bit of thanks to Channel 7 for the promotion there. But it just shows the strength of this project and the strength of the Cobar Basin and what's been happening out here in regional New South Wales, even during COVID lockdown. So it's a great place to explore, and the New South Wales government are right behind us there as well. So that's John Greenfield from the New South Wales government there in the middle, and they're promoting their story, and they were heavily promoting us as well. So it's fantastic collaboration to see. So that's not our only story. We've got a lot of gold in our portfolio as well. This is a really exciting project. Moorefield is an hour east of our Cargelligo project. Moorefield we acquired from Goldfields, Magmatic pre-IPO acquired from Goldfields. Goldfields and Magmatic spent $1.5 million on this project. They found a 15-kilometer strike of gold, and we're going to be focusing on the best zones within that. So gold and arsenic have a very strong correlation here because it's what we consider an orogenic gold system. So gold and arsenic in auger and in auger soil sampling along a 4-kilometer strike. So we're going to be drilling this Elswick Road prospect in November, and also further up at Boxdale and 15 kilometres south at Carlisle Reefs. And we're drilling around some known gold drilling intercepts. So 19 metres at 1.3% gold, 1.3 grams per tonne gold, and at Boxdale there. And then Carlisle Reefs has got some higher grade hits. And these are all shallow drill intercepts. That was the only... that 19 metres at 1.3, there was 6 holes drilled in there, and that was the only drilling campaign ever conducted here. We're going to be doing the second drilling campaign, 4 kilometres strike, and drilling straight into the best gold and arsenic zones. So a really exciting program coming up from us. 15 kilometres along strike is the Carlisle Reefs project. So this is the southern extent of that Boxdale trend. So 15 kilometres strike to the south, we've got existing drilling, which was completed just before our IPO, and they've got some great results there. 30 metres at 1.6, 36 metres at 1.2 grams per tonne gold. And we're just going to be drilling underneath that and extending this this gold zone. So we're not reinventing the wheel, and we're just stepping out, doing very sound, systematic exploration, which is going to be a lot of fun, and to grow this thing. So we've got 15 kilometres of strike. We know there's gold along this whole zone. There's over 100 gold workings in this district. It was a really prolific gold gold mining district back in the day, and a lot to come out of this. Gundagai in our south is our third project. At Gundagai, we've got a 1.5 kilometre long gold in soils trend, 3 historic holes underneath this, and lots of gold here. So McPhillamys is a open pit, the next open pit in New South Wales, 2.1 million ounce open pit in reserve that Regis Resources is looking to get permitting on in the next quarter or the next half. So that will be the next gold mine in Australia, gold mine in New South Wales. And this project here at Gundagai has got very similar geometries and pathfinder geochemistry to that. So some really exciting upcoming drilling here as well. Thanks, John.
Glenn, thank you very much for taking us through Australian gold and copper today. We've got some questions that have come through from investors. First of all, would you consider joint ventures?
Of course. So, well, we've got a really experienced board. We've all been involved in acquisitions, and we're always looking at what's around us. And part of that is also benchmarking our own projects, making sure that we're comfortable within ourselves that we've got the best projects for our organic growth. We just IPO'd in January. We constantly benchmark, and we're very comfortable that our $7 million that we've got in the bank currently is best spent on our projects, because we're just not seeing anything else around us that's anything better than what we've got. So, of course, we're always looking. We have no reason at all to joint venture out our projects, because we don't think that's going to be the best value for our shareholders at the moment.
Now, investors are always looking for value. Another question that came through: following recent discoveries in the area, did this add an acquisition premium to your share price?
Yeah, no, it hasn't. But you're right, there has been some just incredible discoveries in the Cobar Basin and adjacent basins to us. But certainly they have not added a premium to our share price. I've been a buyer more recently of us, and obviously I invite everyone else to be also. So just some of those recent discoveries: Constellation by Eris Resources. Last week or 2 weeks ago, they announced 18 meters at 9% copper from 50 meters. That's a discovery that was only under 1 meter of transported cover. So these things exist still, John. Aurelia Metals Federation discovery is just absolutely taking the world, taking Australia by storm. 70 meters at 18% lead plus zinc was one of their last announcements on the 30th of June, and also their Great Cobar. They've had great success with copper there as well. So Peel Mining are constantly releasing from their Mallee Bull, these are all in the same basin as us. So 62 meters at 2% copper with a higher grade core of 25 meters at 4%. So this is really what we're going for and at Achilles, and what our diamond drill hole has the chance to produce, because they're all still happening in the basin.
All right, Glenn, next up, really, just to touch on what polymetallic grades would you need to see to warrant follow-up drilling, just to give investors a bit of an idea what to look out for.
Sure, yeah, great question. So it's a combination. So we just announced 85 metres at 0.13% copper. Most geologists would be burning a hole in their pocket to drill a diamond hole underneath that. But when you couple that 0.1% copper, and that's not all grade, we need to understand that all ore bodies have a low grade shell and a high grade core. So we believe we're well within that low grade shell. We've mapped it out for 700 meters. We've still got the whole thing is sort of 3 kilometers long just in soils. So we're mapping it out. But when you couple just grades, you don't want to just look at grades in isolation, because that can lead you astray. But when you have 85 meters of 0.13% copper and a deeper EM conductor, and you've seen that the whole body of rock is also mineralized, well, then definitely they're the sort of grades that you want to be chasing up and following up.
Okay, Glenn, just a quick one to finish. We're going to ask all presenters today this: how's the company's valuation proposition compare to peers?
Great. I mean, we're very low. In my opinion, of course, $7 million in the bank. Our share price is $12 million. You take that away, it's about a $5 million EV with a drill 500 meter diamond hole collaring today. Lots of money in the bank to follow up success. We think we're pretty well priced for a buyer's entry point at the moment, and we've got a pretty exciting program coming up over the next 6 months. So we think pretty well. Thanks.
Well, we thank you for the update on Australian gold and copper today. Thank you very much for your time and an interesting, evolving story. So we hope you present again in the future.
Thanks, John. You bet.
I'd now like to welcome our next presenter, Peter, on behalf of Magmatic Resources. Hi there, Peter.
Yeah, g'day, John. Yeah, thanks for having me.
So you're right to fire away there, Peter. You can just toggle left and right with either your key or your mouse at the bottom.
Yeah, sorry, John. I just can't see my presentation yet. If you could bring that up.
Okay, we're just queuing that up for you now, Peter, and then we'll get underway.
No dramas. Thank you.
All right, Peter, thank you very much for joining the Proactive webinar series today. Take us away.
Beauty, John. Yeah, thanks for having me. Apologies about the delay there. It's a pleasure to provide an update on Magmatic. We're an East Lachlan focused copper gold explorer as opposed to Glenn's central Lachlan focus. We're even more focused now on our advanced portfolio in the East Lachlan as a consequence of the spin out and our involvement with AGC. We're in an area where we have significant producers to world-class province. We've got Australia's largest gold producer there at Cadia East, churning out 900,000 or so ounces per year at about negative 500 Aussie dollars per ounce. So very globally substantial mine there at Cadia East, and other substantial mining operations at North Parks and Cowal, and also Alkane's Tomingley, which is relevant to the Magmatic portfolio. We have inherited and what was purchased, a counter-cyclical acquisition, the Magmatic portfolio out of Goldfields back in around 2014. And so as a consequence from that, they'd spent a lot of money developing targets. So we're coming in on these at a more advanced stage. A lot of them are drill ready to go. We're proximal to those mining operations. In the case of Wellington North, we're north from Cadia, and essentially surrounding the tenure surrounding Alkane's recent Boda discovery, which is a very substantial discovery in the Lachlan and north of Cadia, and we've got a great opportunity there to add value. Also, I'll be discussing here recent work in defining targets around an old historic goldfield, the Badangra goldfield, which is arguably one of the earliest records of historic gold production in the country, in Australia, with substantial production there, 230,000 ounces at 26 grams per tonne gold. So we've brought that into our target mix recently, and we'll be drilling there in the near future. Also, our Mile project, which is north of North Parks in that western Junee narrow mine belt within the East Lachlan. That we've been working there earlier in the year, and returning substantial wide zones of copper mineralization. And just checking you're right, you can still hear me there, John. The connection seems to have dropped. That seems okay, but I can't see you. I'll continue for now. We've got drilling coming up there at Kingswood, a compelling copper porphyry opportunity, 50 k's north of North Parks, and our orogenic gold project at Parks within that Parks fault zone south of the Tomingley gold operations. High impact drilling coming up there, as I said, at the Badangra goldfield, where we've got very substantial grades on display, and also including underground channel sampling results. Corporately, tightly held company, Goldfields, as I said, where the assets came out of, major shareholders, where well capitalized to deliver multiple discovery opportunities. And we'll carry on. I'll keep it moving. But stepping back into the East Lachlan, you can see there in orange Magmatic's portfolio, North Acadia, surrounding Boda, and we've got the Marlin Parks projects there. I'll keep moving. This zooms in on Wellington North. Air Mag image shows quite nicely our tenure surrounding Alkane's Boda tenure. They're very active there, of course, post-discovery and drilling out and finding shallower resources as well. So it's developing as a really exciting story. We're positioning our other targets, obviously, to leverage that story, but we've got some exciting opportunities here. In the mix from the high-grade lodes that are evident in the old goldfield at Badangra to more epithermal porphyry-looking targets elsewhere in the portfolio. Badangra Goldfield, as I said, it's very, very early production historically within the country, back to the 1840s. We've got rock chips of the mineralisation and also underground channel sampling results, which are suggesting very, very high grades. And the work that we'll be doing shortly there will be targeting drill targets near mine extensions, stepping underneath the old workings, looking for extensions down plunge and along strike. This shows some more detail at one of the two major historic mines there within the Badangra field and Mitchell's Creek, very, very limited drill testing beneath that. And we're seeing zones to the north as well where we're stepping up into sort of 8-9 metre wide zones. It has epithermal affinities. We're seeing a lot of sulfides within the mineralogy of the veining, which is suggesting these are juicy epithermal lodes, probably connected to the genesis of Boda, which is only it's only 700 metres from our tenement boundary in this area. Dick's Reward, again, that shows as well some of the old hits down dip, but most of them remain open, and also the channel sampling, which is in situ, sampled back in the late 80s. The Mile Project, stepping west into the Junine Aramine Belt. Geophysics works really well in this belt in particular. Gravity imagery highlights the location, for example, of the North Parks and Cowal mining complexes and deposits. And so the Miles critically has one of those low gravity features within it, within the broader magnetic belt. Also, we're leveraging off substantial shallow geochemical work, which Goldfields had done and Magmatic also have been building. And we've started drilling beneath intersections, for example, at Kingswood, where we've got 70 metre, 0.54, 1.15 gold, which is pretty much what they're mining down the road. That's the resource grades down the road at North Parks. We'll be following that up in the not too distant future. We like the look of Kingswood and that Kingswood corridor as a discovery opportunity. We're seeing broad zones of mineralisation, the right alteration, the right types of veining as we're stepping down. And also these things again and again occur on the shoulders of some of these monzonite stocks, which is all ticking more boxes along the way of providing confidence for us to continue drilling. Within the Parks project, we're about 25 k's south of the Timmingley discoveries and gold operations, where there's about 1.8 million ounces, just shy of a 2 million ounce system there now. So very significant gold within the Parks fault zone. We've got very reminiscent of early stage discovery hits from that Timmingley field we've got down here in this Park project. So we'll be following those up on the other side of Christmas. So whilst we've rescheduled a few things, you know, the Badangra targets, we feel worthy of accelerating activity there. We're holding off on Lady Ilsa until we can get an air core rig in there to continue mapping things to the north. We feel like there's a good vector indicated there at Lady Ilsa on the northern side. Fast-tracking Badangra drilling underneath the Dix Reward and Mitchell's Creek mines. And, yeah, the Kingswood drilling and other drilling at Mile will be later in the year. that's probably it for me, John. Thank you.
Thank you very much for presenting today and taking us through Magmatic Resources. Peter, interesting story. We do have some investor questions come in. First one, really quite interesting. At Lady Isle, have you planned any more 1,000-metre holes considering Alkana drilling deeper nearby?
Thanks, John. I got most of that question. Yeah, at Lady also with the deeper drilling, I think it was in relation to the deeper drilling. So, yeah, the current status at Lady Ilsa, we're excited about that target as we have been sort of active on that over the last 18 months. It shows a lot of the features. You know, if you look back at August 15, 2017, the Alkane announcement, that was a previous life for me, describes clearly, you know, what we're looking for in terms of a Boda lookalike. So we've been defining that system with a few phases of drilling. We've got one deep hole into it that we did relatively early on, which was critical for mapping the system and structure. And now the entire data set we can see is showing us where the alteration is within the system. And we've got some broad zones of gold anomalism there as well. So deep holes are expensive, so we tend to want quite a few reasons and lines of evidence before we commit to them.
Okay, next up, what grades and widths would you require for a porphyry discovery? Just to give investors a bit more of an idea of what we would need to see.
Sure, John. Yeah, well, I refer back to that, you know, 15th of August 2017. Look it up because it'll really show you what was emerging there at Boda and what was significant. But it's wide zones, you know, 100 plus metres of, 0.3 and with a little bit of copper in the upper level. So at that point, you know, Boda's described as this epithermal upper level type of system with potential for porphyry mineralization at depth. So that's the way we think about it. We do look at it in 3D and obviously look at the width in real space and the volume of rock that's been mineralized as being important before we then sort of shoot deeper holes typically within that at depth.
Okay, well, the next question we're going to involve Alkane again. It's just what the investors have been asking about. So since the Alkane Boda discovery, have you been approached by strategic investors at a project or a company level?
Well, obviously, we'll release any of that sort of more sensitive information as appropriate. But look, it's fair to say that, you know, it sort of put New South Wales back on the map, the Boda discovery. You know, it was sort of a multi-generational discovery, attracted a lot of funding back into New South Wales. It's outcropping, you know, so people are playing the undercover space in many parts of the world, and so for a discovery like Boda to come along really sort of shook things up a bit. And yeah, another part of it was that, you know, it was really a gold system in the shallow levels and really only developed into more of a gold copper system at depth. So that sort of changes the way we're looking for targets in that area. So we had a bit of a paradigm shift, if you like, what we're targeting, what we're looking for. You can see how things would have been missed for decades because Boda shows that that's what happened. So it's upgraded the prospectivity of MAG's portfolio in that area, and we've re-ranked all of our targets based on that developing knowledge by the industry. But a big focus back on the area, in particular that northern Molong Belt area is a real hotspot for that epithermal porphyry mineralisation, you know, in the same belt, north up the road from Australia's largest gold producer. So there's a lot to like about it.
That's interesting times for you, Peter. Now, we're asking all presenters this question today. How does the company's valuation proposition compare to peers?
It's ridiculously low, John. Well, yeah, we're well cashed up. We've got a portfolio there of advanced drill-ready, you know, discovery opportunities. You know, often you're dealing with a multi-year sort of defining process of getting targets ready. And so we're trying to be methodical about it and reacting to data as we bring it in. We're trying to be nimble and spend the money as wisely as possible. You know, we're doing what we can there to get the money in the ground. Look, when you look at our cash position, I think we're pretty attractive as an entry. And as news flow, we'll be increasing our news flow as we come into, you know, the typical drill season and trying to bring multiple targets in and test them back to back as quick as possible.
Great, Peter. Gives investors some news flow to look out for. So thank you very much for presenting today on behalf of Magmatic Resources, and hopefully we'll see you again soon.
Pleasure, John. Thank you.
I'd now like to welcome our final presenter, Pip, to present on behalf of Sipper Resources. Welcome along, Pip.
G'day, John. How are you going?
Good, thank you.
Well, thanks for inviting me. And good morning and afternoon to everybody who's taking the time. Much appreciated. Thanks to the previous presenters. And, congratulations for working in New South Wales at the moment and keeping things moving. That's a great effort. Okay, so I am the Managing Director of Sipper Resources. Here's a lovely photo of the pathway to our Paterson North project out in the Paterson region. We've got a joint venture with Rio Tinto. Standard disclaimer there, basically seek alternative investment advice before purchasing our shares. Okay, so in summary, Sipper is a greenfields explorer. Most of our projects are based here in Western Australia. We have six projects we're actively exploring here in Western Australia. We've actually got a nickel-copper project in Uganda that's currently on care and maintenance. It was previously in joint venture with Rio Tinto. But all of our energy at the moment and our funds are being directed to our projects here in WA. We had projects in other states, but with the movement restrictions, made much more sense to bring all of our projects back into Western Australia. So we've got large ground position in some key mineral provinces in WA that I'll talk about shortly. And in terms of upcoming news flow, we're awaiting assay results from drilling at our Murchison project. From drilling, we recently completed at our Warralong project. And a giant IP survey we just completed on the joint venture with Rio Tinto in the Paterson. So we're just awaiting the results from that. And we've just completed preparations for further drilling at Wolf Basin up in the Kimberley. So a fair bit of news flow coming up over the coming months. And as we move towards the end of the drill season here in WA, in the northern part, I guess where most of our projects are focused. But we do have another project at Skeleton Rocks down in the southern part of WA. You can see there on the map, and we're planning to drill that over the summer. The snapshot of our corporate summary there, we had 180 million shares on issue. We actually literally, as the other guys were talking, just came out of a trading halt for a capital raise we just completed. So shortly those shares on issue will increase, and I can talk a bit more about that perhaps at the end. A few options and a share price of roughly 6 cents, a market cap of just under 11 million. Our last quarterly, we revealed we had 3.5 million of cash in the bank, so we're well funded for all our current activities, drilling and exploring in other ways those projects I highlighted earlier. On the board, probably too many geologists there. I'm a geologist. Our chair, more of a finance investment banking background. Tim Kennedy, a geologist, and John, also a geologist, but investment banking background as well. So what's the investment opportunity we see for Sipper Resources? It's basically, you know, leverage to discovery. Discovery at our multiple gold and base metal projects here in Western Australia, and we're actively progressing those projects. So with our low enterprise value, any discovery there would have a result in significant kind of re-rating for us. So there's a number of projects there that we're moving forward. I'll go through them individually. And on the right there, you can see where we're spending our dollars over the coming year. Big focus in gold and base metals. We don't have any specific rare metals or industrial metals exposure, apart from our Warralong Gold Project, which does have potential for lithium. but we haven't focused on that specifically at this point. So the first project I'd like to talk to you about is our Warralong project. It's located in the Pilbara region of Western Australia here, and it's located on a large shear zone, the Lalarook shear zone, which sits to the east of the Tabba Tabba shear zone. And both of these features you can see very readily in government geophysics and other imagery. And the Tabba Tabba shear zone to the west there, I worked on previously when I was the exploration manager at Atlas Iron. And I was always intrigued by it because there's a large number of deposits along this particular shear zone. So we were working on Mount Dove, which is an iron deposit, when I was up there. And there are a couple of lithium deposits, lithium tin tantalum deposits. But there's also, people have obviously heard of Hemi, which is that huge gold discovery by Gray. So a number of deposits along this shear zone. And so what SEPA are doing are exploring a very large shear zone that's to the east, which is, we see it as analogous to that, very similar geological setting. And if you follow that shear zone further to the southwest, it runs into the Pilgangoora district where there are the lithium deposits. There's iron deposits I worked on around Abydos for Atlas Iron. And so we've picked up a large package of ground there, about 1,000 square kilometres, covering that shear zone and the splays off that shear zone, and it's systematically testing that as those tenements are being granted. And our project area, which is shown a little bit more detail here in this magnetic image, it's basically almost completely unexplored, primarily because it's covered in thin sheet wash, so between 5 and 20 metres of sand and floodplain deposits. It's a large river, the De Grey River, that kind of bisects that area. And so no one's previously drilled this area. So what we've been doing recently is testing those basement rocks that are obscured under that shallow cover, following up targets that we generated out of some detailed air mag we flew last year. So across that area, you can see in the map, there's a number of intrusive or bodies and a lot of basement complexity that indicates that this area isn't just a generic granite as it had been typically thought of in the past. So we're following up that complexity. We've completed one drill program there already, and we're just completing the preparations to ideally get a second program completed before the end of the year. And so we're testing those targets we generated from the air mag, as well as getting some understanding of the basement, because the whole area is completely obscured. So Murchison, that's another gold-focused project we have located in more in the central part of Western Australia, and very close to the mining centre of Meekatharra. There's a number of active mills run by Westgold in the district, and we've got about 460 square kilometres of ground in this area, covering the Abbott's Greenstone Belt in the northern part of that image. And this year we've completed two air core programs following up historic trends seen the work done by previous explorers, and we're just waiting on assays from the most recent round of drilling there. We've got several tenements under application, and as those are granted, we can move on to test some new targets. Many of you may have heard of the Paterson region. That's, I guess, been pretty exciting and got a lot of attention recently from Rio Tinto's discovery of Winu, a large copper gold system that they're progressing at the moment. Entered into a farm-in and joint venture agreement with Rio Tinto Exploration about July last year, and Rio Tinto are spending money to earn into that project in a staged manner, with SEPA as the operators of that project. So this is our second joint venture with Rio Tinto. I mentioned earlier previously had won over a Uganda nickel copper project. So Rio need to spend $6 million to earn a 55% interest in the project. We've just about through the first season of work on that. And importantly in this deal, prior to Rio being able to withdraw, they need to complete about 4,000 metres of drilling. This area is all undercover of varying thicknesses. And so drilling is absolutely vital to progressing projects in this district to be able to actually sample really what's going on in the basement. So this year we've been doing a lot of the preparatory work that will underpin a solid drilling program in 2022, again funded by Rio as part of that joint venture. So this year we've completed large heritage surveys as well as a huge gradient array IP survey. And I'll just show you in this map here, you can see the outline of that. So the scale of that's pretty significant. That's about 40 kilometres long by about 15 kilometres wide. So a very extensive gradient array IP survey, and we'll take the information from that survey, add it to the existing geophysics, airborne magnetics, airborne EM, and feed into our drill targeting, which will then underpin next year's drilling. Gradient array, what's important to understand is that gradient array has been previously successful in identifying mineralised areas in the project. So we're kind of leveraging what we know has worked in the district as well as Rio's expertise in the area. I mean, Rio are a great partner to work with on this project. They discovered Winu, so they obviously know what they're doing, and they're very motivated to make another discovery nearby to underpin the economics of that discovery. So we're very happy to be working with Rio. Been working well together, and the farming's going particularly well. Moving on to another project we've recently completed a fair bit of work on. So that's at Wolf Basin. So this is in the northern part of Western Australia, at the south end of the Kimberleys, where we're testing a neoproterozoic sedimentary basin for sediment-hosted base metals. And this, what's interesting about this particular basin is it's never actually been tested previously by drilling, by previous exploration, which is quite unheard of here in Western Australia. So we've got a large land position here, those two tenements you can see on the map, covering that particular package, the Ruby Plains group there. And along that dashed line, you can see that extends all the way down from pretty much the northern end of the project, all the way down to the kind of southwest corner. That's what we're defining as the prospective horizon. So there's many tens of kilometres of this prospective horizon. And as you go along this horizon, you can see a lot of evidence for mineralisation matching the African copper belt style model. And it's got base metal soil anomalies over 40 kilometres long along that horizon. And there's outcropping gossans on those kind of red patches you can see on the dashed line there, and where those prospects are, for example, Romulus. So we're going with a bit of a wolf theme there. Romulus and Remus are the names of those two gossans. So these are sticking out of the ground, and there's not too many places in Western Australia you can still find gossans sticking out of the ground these days. And so I guess that's where we've focused our initial work. Now, I mentioned that African copper belt type model. It's a pretty well-known type model for base metal mineralisation. And this cartoon image shows that, where you've got these porous rocks in the yellow, metal-bearing fluids move along that. And then as they rise up and come into contact with reactive rocks like shales and carbonates, they drop out and form, hopefully, sulphide base metal deposits. And what we see at Wolf Basin is, in all the drilling we've done and all the work, that this model actually matches exactly what is on the ground. So we've got sandstones, and then immediately above those are these shales and carbonates, and right at the contact are the gossans I mentioned earlier. So our first program, we decided to test some of those targets, again, just to confirm the model. We received some funding from the West Australian Government Exploration Incentive Scheme to support that. And when we drilled the holes, we got results up to just under 0.5% copper and 3% lead. So that's an absolutely terrific outcome, because it shows you that the model is correct. There's metal in the system, and now we are focused on zeroing into where exactly the those metals would be concentrated into, hopefully a base metal sulfide deposit. The other thing to note is this is just one horizon that we're focused on at the moment. It's a large project, and there are additional target horizons in other parts of the basin that may exist that we can explore. Here's some results from that drilling, and you can see this was the first drill program ever completed in the basin to our knowledge. So very shallow cover, a few metres, and we get these in the grey, those kind of shales and carbonates, the reactive rocks. The blue is the dolomite dominant kind of stratigraphy, and then underneath it, the sandstone. And right on the contact, you'll find there's those gossans outcropping on the western side where it sticks up out of the ground, and then we're getting up to 30% pyrite and metal numbers in the drilling that we've done today. Now we followed that up with some IP, so just to look a bit harder, a little bit along strike. So if we go to the next slide, you can see our drill holes from last year and these, you know, nice kind of bullseye kind of images there. So the big blobs is kind of like the classic, you know, drill here kind of thing. And, you know, it again adds further weight to our model. We're getting a bit of a pyrite halo with some metal numbers that matches, you know, on the margins of these IP anomalies. So we've completed the preparations now to diamond drill test those anomalies, and that's what we're hoping to do before the season breaks. So that's Wolf Basin. Better crack on a bit here. Got another project that I mentioned that is something we'll be able to work in the West Australian summer. That's in the southern part of Western Australia. We call it Skeleton Rocks, and that's located near the Southern Cross Greenstone Belt, which is immediately east of our project area. You can see some of the known mines there, Marvel Lock and Yilgarn Star, for example. And there's a linking fault that crosses between that and called the Coolanook Fault. We've pegged a large package of ground covering that, and what are very clearly some rafts of greenstone that have never been drill tested under shallow cover there, and in some cases outcropping. So again, limited to no drill testing here. We're just waiting for those tenements to be granted, and things are on track for us to drill them over the summer. Barbed Wire Terrace is a joint venture we've got with Buru Energy, and it's a base metals targets along a very large structure called the Fenton Fault, and it's chasing MVT style lead zinc deposits on the opposite side of that Fitzroy Trough you can see in that kind of pale colour in the centre of the image. And on the opposite side of that, there are very well known lead zinc deposits, Pilara, Kajabut, and so on. So we're chasing analogous mineralisation on the opposite side. We've partnered with Buru Energy on this because of the work they've already done, a significant amount of work on seismic in the area, in their petroleum exploration. So it's a minerals project that's tapping into petroleum expertise and petroleum systems approach. So it's a great partnership. And you can see there's a huge amount of pegging that's just gone on recently in the last month. And so that's pretty encouraging. We're obviously not the only people that have recognised the potential of the area. Okay, Uganda, I mentioned briefly, currently on care and maintenance, a high value prize being a nickel copper sulphide deposit. Basically there's great intercepts, it's open down dip, and we're in the middle of seeking a joint venture partner to help us progress that one. And just to finish up, so in summary, SEPA's leverage to exploration success, multiple projects being actively progressed here in Western Australia, and the low enterprise value means that any success will mean significant re-rating. Thanks very much.
Pip, thank you very much for taking us through Super Resources today. We've got some investor questions. Well, the first one really, you've just come out of the trading halt for the capital raising. The question came in, the capital raising included an Australian Specialist Resource Fund. Is this the first time this fund has invested with SIPA, or are they an existing shareholder?
Look, thanks for the question. Yes, look, we just came out of the halts, you know, moments ago. And yes, correct, it is the first time they have invested in SIPA. And look, it's really encouraging to have an investor like that come on board. Just, you know, it validates what you're doing. Greenfields type exploration isn't for everyone, but, you know, our approach is very systematic, technically based, and it's just a great validation of what we're doing.
Now, you did go through a multiple projects there, Pip. Now, would you consider additional farming agreements?
Sure. Look, farming agreements, we've got so two joint ventures at the moment. Always happy to look at taking on other partners. We're the operator of both of our one's a farm in, hasn't reached a joint venture stage. The other one it's a joint venture. Yes, happy to look at others. You love your projects, but you know, you've got to be pragmatic in this industry. It is a high risk industry. And so if there's ways to leverage other partners' expertise and skills, and also to lay off some of your risk, then that would be a good thing. I think it's very important to make sure you choose the right partner. In our case, for example, I talked a bit about Rio being a great partner in the area around Winu, where they know a lot. And Buru, you know, are a great partner in the Canning Basin. Again, they're very knowledgeable in that area. So you've got to, combine your strengths to make a 1+1=3 kind of situation.
There was a question touching on the JV with Rio Tinto Exploration, Pip. So are you able to take us through just the timeline for their obligations? Are they going along at an expected speed, or faster or slower than anticipated?
Going along at the anticipated rate. The Paterson is an area it's very seasonal at the early stage exploration stage. So you can work from probably April through till late October, then it gets pretty challenging. This year we've completed what is actually a huge amount of work in getting the very large scale heritage survey and that huge IP survey done. And that's all setting us up for drilling next year. And the drilling next year will be, you mentioned obligations. So Rio are obligated to complete 4,000 metres of drilling on the project prior to withdrawal, should they choose to withdraw. We don't see any reason why they would. But so that drilling most logically will occur next season. And that would take them a long way toward meeting the $6 billion first stage farm-in to reach 55%.
Pip, the final question we are asking all presenters today, how does the company's valuation proposition compare to peers?
I think it's low. I've been buying shares on market. You can see our announcements there. And directors all participated in the capital raise that just completed. So I guess I'm not alone in the board in thinking that we're, undervalued. And we really see ourselves as very leveraged to any exploration success that we have.
Pip, thank you very much for taking us through Super Resources today. An interesting and evolving story. We hope you come back and present again in the future. So that now wraps up Practice Resource webinar with a special focus on the valuation proposition today. Also like to thank Glenn and Peter who presented early. So thank you very much, everyone, and we'll see you again soon.
Thank you.